I'm Pam Thompson. I manage the adult education programs here for the Arnold Arboretum. Now I will turn it over to Keith Morgan, who will introduce Hope. Thank you, Keith.
This evening, we're here to have an opportunity to hear about and to just rejoice in the publication of this important monograph on Arthur Shurcliff. It's my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Elizabeth Hope Cushing, who has been a fellow traveler of mine for a great many years. Therefore, it is a particular privilege and pleasure for me to have the opportunity to introduce her. Hope fell in love with Arthur Shurcliff a good long time ago and has had an intense relationship that has resulted in this marvelous book. I had the pleasure of serving as the director of Hope's dissertation on this particular topic and fought hard to make her throw out lots of material that she fought equally hard to keep in, and you're all the beneficiary of her not listening to my advice along the way. This is an amazing story of a key fellow who is a product of the arts and crafts movement at a very intense level, who collaborated with his wife, Margaret Homer Shurcliff, who's also very important as a part of the story. There are many Arthur Shurcliffs that we need to know deeply about, and Hope has opened up that discourse beautifully and eloquently for us, leading to the important development, of course, of Colonial Williamsburg, that restoration that would never have happened if it were not for Boston-based landscape architects and architects designing the entire establishment. So it is with great pleasure that I introduce my colleague Elizabeth Hope Cushing to talk to you about one of her fascinations.
I can't tell you how excited I am to be here tonight. It's just so wonderful that this has come to fruition. In point of fact, tonight is a time to honor this man. And it is time to honor him, too. Arthur Aziel Shurcliff, a shaper of land and an extraordinary person, who combined in his makeup the mechanical and the aesthetic, the intellect and the deeply felt sentiment. In 1930, when he was 60 years old, with a thriving practice in landscape architecture in Boston and beyond, a New Hampshire acquaintance wrote inquiring what he thought his place in history might be. Shurcliff, who at that moment was 2 years into the largest and most important commission of his career at Colonial Williamsburg, replied diffidently, "As far as I know, the only honor which may ever come to me is that I had sense enough to record some of the lovely old New England places, parks, commons, and waterfronts, which are so rapidly being forgotten." His massive undertaking at Williamsburg was the culmination of years of reflection about and study of the American past, though he clearly must have been conscious of the fact that his reputation would have larger implications. It is telling that he identified himself with preservation, history, and an appreciation of disappearing landscapes, including, quite presciently, the farmscape. Through the years, I have come to discover, in part through reading his journals and private correspondence, that Shurcliff was not only a gifted and prolific landscape designer, but a fascinating, complex, and unusual individual as well. An integrated view of both how this man was formed and how the influences that shaped him through the years affected his professional life has been the major focus of my research. Tonight, I would like to share just a few glimpses of Shurcliff, and because a notable amount of his professional life was spent planning and designing for Boston, a brief introduction to his work in this area, so that when you are moving about the city on your daily routines, a light bulb of recognition may go off as you walk or bicycle or drive by one of his designs. Born just 5 years after the terrible upheaval of the Civil War, he accomplished the majority of his work in an era marked by two world wars and periods of serious economic instability. During his lifetime, Americans shifted from dependence on gaslight to the use of electricity. Of more significance, however, was the rapid progression from horsepower as the primary means of conveyance to
to the advent and rapid acceleration of automobile usage. He was born Arthur Aciel Shurcliff at 9 Cedar Street on Beacon Hill. He changed his name in 1930 in order, he said, to conform to the ancient spelling of the family name. No one, not even his wife and children, ever knew why he did it. The Shurcliffs were a loving and nurturing family consisting of his mother, Sarah Ann Keegan Shurcliff, shown here with baby Arthur, his father, Aciel Milton Shurcliff, an inventor and manufacturer of fine surgical instruments, four siblings, among them the two older brothers whom you saw a moment ago, Howard and Ernest, and a beloved younger sister, Gertrude Hope Shurcliff, whom Shurcliff remained close to all his life. The two are shown here with their younger brother, Alfred. The Shurcliffs raised the five children in the narrow brick row house, steeping them in music, art, literature, and history, both American and family. And Mr. Shurcliff taught woodworking to each child on the fourth floor workshop. Here you see the teenage Shurcliff at work. It was a skill that took deep root in him, and he practiced it in various forms for the rest of his life. Just as the Shurcliffs were affected by the historical aspects of the Colonial Revival movement that swept New England in the 1870s, they were also influenced by the arts and crafts movement that left the Atlantic from England straight to Boston in 1897 with an exhibition held at Copley Hall. For New England, at least, the Colonial Revival and arts and crafts movement intertwined seamlessly, particularly for Arthur Shurcliff. Shortly after the Society of Arts and Crafts was formed, the year after the exhibition, both Arthur and Gertrude Shurcliff became members. Summers for the Shurcliffs were spent in the countryside surrounding Boston. Here, a particularly beloved spot, the Riddell Farm in nearby Waverly, where the children were steeped in the joys of country living and introduced to nature by their parents and through their free-roaming rural life. On the property were the Waverly Oaks, giant aboriginal trees first made famous in the poetry of James Russell Lowell, then later when their preservation served as Charles Eliot's initial argument for the creation of the Metropolitan Park Commission in 1893. Shurcliff visited at least annually. Indeed, he was so deeply attached to these trees that years later, when it came time to request the hand of his intended in 1905, the deed was accomplished in the lower branches of the Here, on a page from one of the journals he kept in the 1880s, you can see he recorded a map of the very spot where he proposed. Each autumn, the family went to the White Mountains for the enjoyment of mountain, lake, forest, and stream. Here you see Aciel Shurcliff preparing to accompany the coach to Kearsarge, where they stay in one of the large seasonal hotels, the Ridge. Shurcliff's inventiveness exhibited itself in any situation. During an 1891 stay at the Ridge, finding he had mistakenly left his violin at home, in 2 days' time, he manufactured one out of an old cigar box and a piece of wood found in a local wood pile. He also created a six-hole golf course, his first recorded landscape, where he used his own handmade golf clubs to play and to teach other guests to play, as he said, for the fun of it. Camping, hiking, and sketching in those mountains remained important to Shurcliff all his life. The Shurcliffs also spent time on Nantucket Island in order to savor oceanside pleasures and the pursuit of local history. Here, a photograph taken by Aciel Shurcliff at the behest of his son of the Jethro Coffin House, labeled Oldest House, Nantucket Town. Shurcliff spent his youth canoeing and camping along the Charles River that, as you know, flows from Hopkinton down through Cambridge, then spills into the sea at Boston Harbor. Here you see a handmade kayak with sails that he used up and down the Charles in the tent he made for camping. The making and paddling of kayaks was another lifelong pleasure, one he taught his children as well. It probably comes as no surprise to you by this time that Shurcliff was deeply influenced by the New England transcendentalists, Emerson and particularly Henry David Thoreau, whose writings he read at length and indeed did his best to live by. Eventually, he wrote 4 books of meditations himself. He also records that one summer, while staying in Wellesley, he was introduced, and I quote, to Dante, Browning, Tennyson, Burne-Jones, John Ruskin, and the Pre-Raphaelites by Wellesley College campuses. All his life, Shurcliff carried a small 4x6 sketchbook tucked in his pocket. You can see the tip of it peeking out right here, in order to record his excursions and the sights he saw in his travels. Here a page from one of his many sketchbooks. In 1889, Shurcliff, who had indeed proved himself an inventive type like his father, set off for training at MIT, intending to join, indeed intended for, the family manufacturing business. Gradually, however, the stultifying nature of mechanical engineering bore in upon him. After 4.5 years of intense training, the dutiful son was no longer able to conform to familial expectations. Heavens, he wrote in his journal in the spring of 1894, after a field trip to the mills and barns, am I a mechanical engineer? Am I to do such awful work? How about the trees? How about the sky? I had forgotten all of them. By now, he was fully convinced that a satisfying career would need to combine his love of landscape and country matters with the mechanical skills he had acquired at MIT. An amalgamation of his interests and abilities into a personally and professionally satisfying whole. After talking to his disappointed but ever devoted father, Shurcliff instantly wrote a letter to this man. America's most renowned and gifted landscape architect, someone familiar to you all, Frederick Law Olmsted, who, as it happened, lived in nearby Brooklyn. How he knew of the nascent profession of landscape architecture is not entirely clear, although 50 years later he wrote, to this art I came naturally through the tastes of my early days and the tastes of my family. There was a stronger reason as well, being my interest in country scenery, landscape sketching and painting, natural history, bicycling, camping, Emerson, and the journals of Thoreau. These influences led me away from mechanics towards scenery, from planning and construction for the scenes of daily life. 3 months after he wrote this letter, Shurcliff pedaled the 3 miles to Brookline on his bicycle, where Olmsted spoke to him at length, assuring him that a significant amount more school and training would be required to become a landscape architect. And then he turned him over to another familiar figure, Charles Eliot, son of Charles W. Eliot, president of Harvard, Olmsted's protege, and the rising star of the Olmsted office. Eliot patiently helped Shurcliff piece together a program at Harvard, steadily guiding him over the 2-year period required to get his second Bachelor of Science. Then he took him on as an apprentice at the Olmsted firm. Here you see Shurcliff, center front, just outside the Brookline offices. Beginning in his teenage years and extending through his time in college and his apprenticeship, Shurcliff went with his father and friends on bicycle trips to surrounding communities, including Concord, the home of his transcendental heroes. Everywhere he went, he made certain to record examples of old New England ways he saw as he traveled along. Here, a sketch of an old mill at Natick, or a coach at Farmington during a trip to Connecticut. This, a postcard sent home from the return journey. At a certain point, his attention fixed itself upon old gardens, and 1899 saw the first of many articles he published on the topic. This, an illustration from one called Some Old New England Flower Gardens in New England Magazine. Frequently through the years, he championed the use of boxwood in old gardens. It was an element of his approach that characterized all of his work in restoration. In fact, he came to be associated with it, largely because of his later work at Colonial Williamsburg. He also wrote about the rapidly disappearing farmscapes dear to his heart and his life. Shurcliff's landscape training ceased when he set up his own practice in 1904. It was an instant success. The problem was never to get work, he later wrote. It came in year after year of itself without request or advertising. The problem was to get the work done on time, and this necessitated extremely strenuous work, for years much too strenuous for comfort. In part, that success was the result of his early interest and involvement in city planning, just beginning in America as he set up practice, a newly burgeoning field in landscape architecture as automobile usage increased dramatically. Cities grew rapidly, and planning for fast-growing suburban communities became essential. The combination of his MIT and Harvard training made this a natural progression for him, along with his intimate familiarity with Boston and the greater Boston area, from his extensive youthful ramblings and from early planning project reports he produced. The next two decades were spent building his practice and honing his skills. At the end of that time, he was a respected practitioner who had helped Frederick Law Olmsted, Jr. establish the first four-year landscape architecture school in America at Harvard and taught there, had become landscape architect for the Metropolitan Planning Board, was chief consultant to the Boston Parks Department, and consultant to the State Highway Commission, not to mention his practice in campus work, significant town planning in the Boston area, and a robust practice in private domestic landscape design. Just over a year after setting up his office in 1905, he married Margaret Homer Nichols. She was a Beacon Hill neighbor and the object of his attention for several years. Not only an excellent archer and crack tennis player, but a devoted woodworker, as well as, in the larger world, a resolute political activist. She proved just the right mate for Arthur Shurcliff, and he for her. Over the next decade, they produced six children. Together, they also embarked upon a building campaign on a bare drumlin in Ipswich, a plot they bought in order to build a summer home. They began with what they called a shack at the crest of the hill overlooking the marshes with the Castleneck River winding through the rolling Castleneck dunes in the distance. It was constructed complete with windmill to fetch their water from the bottom of the hill, a copy of the old windmill at Nantucket from a sketch Shurcliff had made in 1896, a metal windmill, of course, being entirely aesthetically unacceptable to them. Through the years, the house and grounds were transformed into this masonry-enclosed enclave, tucked into the hill and surrounded by thousands of trees planted to screen the house from the road, providing a secluded retreat for family and friends. Within the grounds, they added to the house, shaped the walls, and created additional buildings on the grounds, as well as garden rooms. Within the house, Shurcliff carved paneling, door latches, and doors. Together, the Shurcliffs created almost all of the furniture as needs arose. It was the ultimate haven for the entire family. Summers and weekends of relaxation and rejuvenation in the natural world. Crucial as family and creativity at Ipswich were to Shurcliff, all this, of course, could only be packed into each moment of time left over from his increasing and pressing professional life. Shortly after he set up practice in 1904, Shurcliff announced himself a town planner as well as a landscape architect. From the first decade of the 20th century onward, he was called upon to give landscape lectures in Boston and the surrounding communities. And in these talks, he emphasized the necessity of planning for the future needs of Boston and for the rapidly growing towns surrounding the expanding urban core. By the end of his career, he had consulted with or made plans for over 26 surrounding cities and towns. Shurcliff was also part of the pioneer effort in large-scale city planning for highway improvement. The rapid increase in automobile usage made it clear that the time had come to ensure safe, direct, and expeditious access to Boston by making appropriate connections among the city and the surrounding towns. The Metropolitan Improvement Commission hired him to study the problem in 1907, and, he said, I visited every street, alley, park, nook and cranny of this area, on foot, in horse-drawn carriages, and in the steam and gasoline motor cars of that period. I interviewed the officials in all the cities, towns, and counties, and the state board and federal agencies. The result was a 70-page report issued in 1909 entitled The Metropolitan Plan that suggested that there be put in place direct access for outlying towns, one to another, and also to the city, by mapping the incomplete roads. Then, by making connections on the roads and creating new roads as needed. He proposed carrying automobiles around the many outlying towns rather than having them driving through each one, the traffic being an obvious disruption to community life. In fact, in 1924, he proposed a major circumferential road to relieve pressure within the city as well, not actually realized until after Shurcliff's death, but based on his initial concept, the creation of Route 128. Shurcliff worked for the State Highway Commission for many years, planning roads, parkways, and traffic circles in and around Boston, and he consulted frequently with the Metropolitan District Commission. It was in 1910 that he was appointed advisor to the Boston Parks Department, a post he held for many years thereafter. As you know, in the 1870s and 80s, Frederick Law Olmsted created a system of parks around Boston known as the Emerald Necklace, curving up from the fens that emptied into the Charles and winding back up along Muddy River to Jamaica Pond, terminating in the largest part of the system, Franklin Park. His 1885 plan for that park called for a section to be tucked beside the long greeting for use as a deer park, a zoo, and what he called the Little Folks Fair. It was not, however, until 1910 that Arthur Shurcliff began the development of the zoological garden. Showing his usual deference to Olmstedian principle in design, almost 20 years later he wrote, "Great pains were taken to prevent the zoo from intruding upon the natural landscapes of Franklin Park. To have allowed it to encroach upon the composition of the park would have been so great a loss that the attractions of the animal collections could not have compensated for it." Within the topography began with an elaborate aviary with a flying cage for aquatic birds, embellished by what Shurcliff characterized as naturalistic treatment, and the bear dens. He was particularly proud of them, publishing frequently about their design, considered state of the art at the time. By 1920, the zoo design was finished and half the planned exhibition spaces had been completed. 5 years later, Mayor Curley requested a rose garden to be added to the grounds, which Shurcliff made circular in design, followed by a large rock garden in 1930, constructed opposite the entrance to the rose garden. In a 1927 address before the Boston Society of Landscape Architects and Sculptors, the year before he had assumed his two-term presidency of the American Society of Landscape Architects, Shurcliff highlighted the importance of parks being what he characterized as useful to people, stressing the fine balance the landscape architect must achieve between the importance of providing quiet, naturalistic scenery in an urban setting and the growing demands of the citizenry for playing fields, playgrounds, and, most disquieting of all, the requirements of the automobile. The park designer, he wrote, is torn between a desire to preserve the original landscapes and the pressing duty of accommodating the motor vehicle. As such duties increased for him, they included modified roads, concourses and grade crossings and established landscapes, and the creation of new sorts of roadways and traffic constructs. Shurcliff grew increasingly adept and integrated these apparently antithetical but obligatory alterations and additions, including in already existing parks that required adaptation to modern demands. One such challenge involved a major overhaul of, perhaps the best known of the Emerald Necklace parks, the Back Bay Fens. Here you see it in a form envisioned by Olmsted in 1879. Originally designed to deal with noxious sanitary issues deriving from the tidal nature of the basin that swept water in and out of the muddy river around which it was designed. At least half the area was turned into a storm water storage basin. Olmsted also took the opportunity to restore the ravaged salt marsh, a rare asset on an urban site. The remaining land was to be used for passive recreational purposes. The sanitary plan worked until the damming of the Charles River in 1910, which left the muddy river to stagnate, the cleansing aspect of the design scheme rendered near obsolete, and the park left to the ravages of time and the destructive hand of man. Arthur Shurcliff had been roaming and thinking about the area for years. Here, an 1891 sketch he made on one of his rambles. So, when he was called in by the Parks Department in 1921 to update the Olmsted design to reflect contemporary needs, he had not only a deep understanding of the underlying Olmstedian principles and plans gleaned from his training and his experience in the field, he also carried within him familiar and intimate knowledge of Olmsted design spaces. 5 years later, he wrote in Parks and Recreation magazine that his redesign for the severely degraded park was almost complete, and that the salient changes required included a system of marginal roads to resist the intrusion of structures, the elimination of flower beds and shrubbery designs that had crept into the park, planting to screen the surrounding buildings from sight, and, quote, to frame the naturalistic landscapes of the park itself. Athletic fields, highly controversial in the passive recreational park, were greatly in demand in the 1920s, hence reluctantly conceded to, although here the stadium was confined to one area of the park and bounded by high screened fences. The water course continued Olmsted's design in what Shurcliff called, and I quote, naturalistic course to harmonize with the picturesque treatment of the park, although he did add a lagoon across the street from the Museum of Fine Arts in order to promote the integration of the park and museum. The changes to the park were significant enough that landscape historian Cynthia Zizewski, the ultimate authority on Boston park systems, regards the Back Bay fence in its present configuration as more of a Shurcliff design than an Olmsted one, particularly after Mayor Curley demanded a circular rose garden be added in the 1930s. Throughout Curley's long and colorful career as mayor of Boston, Shurcliff worked on numerous projects for the city, particularly appreciated during the lean years of the Depression. In 1917, Curley asked Shurcliff to address the reconfiguration of an awkward space within the Boston Common, directly opposite the State House. Confusing, crisscrossing paths intersected. Shurcliff replaced them all with architectonic steps down from Beacon Street to the Common, flanking St. Gaudens Shaw's Memorial, and wide, straight, tree-lined paths with the Brewer Fountain as centerpiece at the bottom of the hill. Not only did Curley require that hundreds of playgrounds be built for the less privileged children of Boston, many of which Shurcliff designed, Curley also concerned himself with the recreational needs of the larger population. In this case, a huge oceanside recreational facility, Columbus Park, in South Boston in the 1920s. Shurcliff designed the park and sited all the accompanying beach and bathing facilities, including the famous Bell Street bathhouses, later added Castle Island to this popular public space. Playing fields and passive recreational places were also incorporated. As the years passed, Shurcliff's thoughtful and sophisticated understanding of urban places proved adept in small, tightly spaced projects as well. In 1933, he began the process of transforming what he described as the tenement district in the Old North End, almost exclusively the enclave of Italian immigrants, into what he called a place of sunlight and air in a densely populated district. Its location, design, and execution followed two separate but corresponding precepts. Mayor Curley's, that money spent in Boston should be directed to benefit the less privileged members of society, and Shurcliff's own, based on his Olmsted training, that designing open space, large and small, must serve the needs of all residents. Partially inspired by Curley's recent trip to Havana, the Prado, as he named it. It is now called the Paul Revere Mall because of the Cyrus Dollard statue of Revere added later. The park successfully unified two ends of the social and ecclesiastical spectrum of the city, the historic old line Protestant Christ Church at one end, and Catholic St. Stephen's at the other, a concept surely not lost on Curley, who made no secret of his disdain for old Boston Yankees and their culture. The Mission is primarily a hardscape park that could withstand severe usage and resist vandalism. Shurcliff came up with a handsome scheme featuring the formal elegance sought by Curley, combined with utilitarian and passive recreation. And last, but certainly not least, is his most important riverside project, the Charles River Esplanade. Through the 19th and early 20th centuries, there were myriad schemes laid out for the stretch of land lying along the river that separated Boston from Cambridge, some of them partially fulfilled, most of them not entirely successful. Shurcliff's first, rather fanciful conceit, conceived in 1906 in collaboration with the Gothic revivalist Ralph Adams Cram, and of course based on Isabelle Cité in Paris, was a concept attempted by more than one local designer, but never realized. Many iterations later, in 1928, a full-fledged riverside park scheme was designed by Shurcliff at the behest of the Special Commission on the Charles River, a plan completed by 1936 with an emphasis on creating an area of the river where small boating could be freed from the choppy, rough waters that tended to swamp smaller boats. He designed overlooks, a lagoon, artificial breakwater islands to provide a calm and pleasant haven for those small boats, and of course the music shell you can see up at the top of this photograph that to this day provides thousands of Bostonians with summer concerts, not to mention the famous 4th of July festivities. At the time of Shurcliff's first designs for the Esplanade, he suggested a handsome tree-lined parkway would be incorporated. Beacon Hill residents, already unhappy enough with what they considered to be their private backyards being co-opted by the public, made certain it was defeated. More than 20 years later, public need overcame the initial resistance, and Star Drive was designed and implemented by Shurcliff in the late 1940s. It is still a heavily used artery today. Well, these are but a few of many commissions Shurcliff achieved during his 50 years of practice. In 1928, he took on the enormous task of being chief landscape architect for the restoration and recreation of Colonial Williamsburg. There, he happily mingled his interests and professional skills until his retirement in 1941. While it is an essential element of his oeuvre, Williamsburg is another story unto itself. What I hope you come away with tonight is a hint of his broad-ranging talents and interests, and how he applied them to his life and his work. Indeed, he did achieve what for him was the perfect interweaving of the personal and the professional, a satisfying whole that we are fortunate to experience in our daily lives to this day. Thank you very much. Any questions, I'd be happy to answer. So. Yes?
I'm fascinated by the illustration you had of the constructed island in the middle of the Charles River Basin. I know that Clarence Blackwell, who designed quite a few theaters in Boston, also wanted to do a development there. You said that there were several iterations of that.
Didn't Perry Sean Hepburn have one too, didn't he?
I think John Miller there got one too.
Yeah. A lot of people through the years tried it, and it never seemed to work. I don't even know if the Charles is deep enough to do that, is it? Does anyone in this crowd know? Anyway, it was a wonderful fantasy, but nobody ever pulled it off. There were just so many different efforts to make the embankment, various stages of it, a place where people could recreate, and it wasn't terribly successful before. Certain parts of it, like Charles Knight playing here, or Charles Eliot, worked very well, but until the Esplanade, it didn't, and one summer I lived for 6 weeks across the street from it, across Star Drive, And it was used from literally sunup till sunset. People were there and enjoying it. I think you would have been very pleased. Any other questions?
Well, sorry to talk about these parkways around it. Did you make the way, the arborways? Are they all
They're not sure, no. Okay. There's a whole lot of other people doing this work as well.
Which ones, because you mentioned these three roads and you mentioned 128, but are there others that we see and recognize?
He was doing a lot of, he worked in the State Highway Commission in New Hampshire. He is responsible for Franconia Notch being saved and rescued. And he did it all over the place in lots of town planning that I actually did not work with his town planning. But you know, there's going to be a lot more work done on it for sure. But I set out my naivete to write a critical biography, and it was overwhelmed with the amount of wonderful material. So it was a wonderful situation to be in, but I only did a part of what he's done. He was a terrifically prolific worker and achiever. I think many people is knowing him, doesn't he? Yeah.
Where did you find drawings and papers of Shurcliff?
I was so unbelievably lucky. I stumbled into Shurcliff. I walked into Keith's seminar my first semester of graduate school, and he had Shurcliff on the list of papers to go to at the Mass Historical Society. So I went over there and instantly knew that there was this wonderful person, and very important person who nobody knew about. And then I got to know four of the six children, and Shurcliff never threw anything away. Several of my classmates were groaning about their 17th century research projects. I just kept thinking, I have so much paper, I can't do it. It was wonderful. Bill.
Oh, to whom did he pass the torch when he retired in 1941?
His son started working for him in the 1940s. He really started working full time when earlier than that, when Shurcliff started at Colonial Williamsburg in the 1920s. But then, you know, Sidney Shurcliff, his son, took time out to be in the war and other things. But eventually came back and was a partner with him. And so it was Shurcliff and Shurcliff, and then became Shurcliff, Shurcliff, and Merrill. Vincent Merrill was a draftsman who became a part of him. And he worked up until 2 weeks before he died at 87. So, I mean, Sidney must have been a very patient Yes?
I wonder if you found out that he had a rather favorite palette of plants that he would tend to use, particularly in the public projects that he was involved with, because I have seen some of the residential ones, and there seems to be a thread.
Well, you could probably educate me about that, because I never found him hugely invested in being a plantsman. He certainly knew his plants. He spent time at the Bussey Institute and at the Lawrence Scientific School, but. Tell me what you have in mind in this sort of...
No, I'm thinking of the highway plants particularly that were used during the period he was active, which nowadays we would not use. For instance, Russian olive.
Because they won't hold up?
They're invasive.
That too.
And I was just wondering if what his background or what his choices had been, if they were documented.
I think they were... Forgive me, Mr. Churchill. I think they were fairly standard. I don't think that was where a huge amount of his creativity was involved, but somebody may prove me wrong. Yes?
I'm just curious about house in Ipswich is still standing, if the family's still out there, or what the situation is.
Yes, it's such a fortunate situation. It's very much valued. Arthur Sherwood's great-grandson lives there now.
Wow.
And I haven't seen it in a number of years. One of his daughters lived in it for a long time, and I saw it fairly often then. But it's apparently intact and very much, very much enjoyed. Have you seen it recently?
A year and a half ago.
How did it look?
Fabulous.
It's a wonderful spot.
All right.
Yes.
Hi, you mentioned his seeming to have an affinity for bicycling. Did he incorporate or lobby any designs for bicycles in his
Not
plans?
That I know of. I don't think that was, do you know of anybody who was doing that? Somebody in this audience, there were certainly experts I really might know. But I'm certainly not anything I've ever read. Imagines that he was concerned about that. He was so torn about the automobile because he had a personal moving for the thing. And yet he planned very well and very impressively. It's an interesting combination. Yes?
Since he had some travels in Franconia, gosh, which is a significant distance from here, and in the same time frame, Rockefellers were working in Acadia. Do you happen to know any research, did you find any evidence of him ever being in Acadia?
No. Not, but that doesn't mean he wasn't. I mean, there's so much more to do than
You mean so much more resources?
Yeah, no, but yes, there's plenty of material out there. I mean, there was 14 linear feet at Colonial Williamsburg alone that I had to get through. It was just a lot, but I mean, that's such a lucky thing. It's not a complaint. He kept every diary, every scrap of paper, lots of his papers from high school and grade school, all of them. Yes?
I remember hearing one man, his criticism of the Greenway, that the Esplanade initially was not very popular by most Bostonians.
It depends on who you were. There was a certain group who were very upset about it leaving the realm. I mean, really, basically, Beacon Street and that whole neighborhood had used that as their private park always. It was like their backyard. So they had a very hard time transitioning to it being an open space. But it was very popular from the beginning with everybody else, which is a fairly large section of the population.
Is it true he didn't drive?
Oh, never. Never. And one of the anecdotes I tell in my book is that Vincent Merrill said that as a young draftsman, he was made to go along with Shurcliff when he was taking a taxi to the train to go down to Williamsburg, and that Shurcliff would actually crouch down in the taxi so he didn't have to see pretending he was working papers. No, he never loved it. Catherine?
Given how prolific he was, how large was his office?
He never had more than four or five draftsmen in his Boston office. There was a separate office at Williamsburg from 1928 to 30 when they were really intense. And then when the Depression came, Rockefeller did a wonderful thing, which was he publicly declared in the newspaper that his man in New York, said they were putting another $1 million into Williamsburg to keep people employed. But even so, all the private offices had to shut down, and the Williamsburg office shut down. And then, in 34, when the first phase of Williamsburg was over, they purposely got rid of all the outside architects, landscape architects, whoever, most of them, and got in-house people as their own corporation. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.